The mountains will move every chain of the past. You've broken into over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Every giant will fall.
Message is awesome. There were giants in the land, but yet God said, go. Go and conquer that land. Go and claim it as your own. And sometimes we just stand back because we're afraid to move forward. We see too many roadblocks, too many giants in front of us. Know that God is with us when he's asking us to move forward. So we praise you today, Lord. We thank you for your guidance, but not just that, that you stand beside us, that you go with us. Thank you for that. Thank you for the strength that is in that. Thank you for the hope that is in that. Thank you for that blessing. Amen.
Amen.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to seal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. When I stand in your love, my fear doesn't stand a chance. When I stand in your love.
Alyssa and Josh and their beautiful children and even Grandma and Grandpa are here this morning. So good to see Laura and Lee here today as well, helping out with the kids, it looks like. But what a joy it is to have them here today. It was kind of a surprise visit. Josh and I connected earlier this year, and then kind of out of the blue, here they are in the States, and Josh is going to share a little bit about what's happening over there in Germany. As most of you know, we have four missionary groups that we support. We have two local ministries, one at Campus Crusade for Christ, one the Edge Urban Fellowship downtown, and then the Howells, and here today, the Crooks. So I'm excited to have Josh share some things about their ministry and when they're heading back. So Josh?
Thank you. Guys, I got to say, it is so sweet to stand in this room and worship with all of you. It's such a privilege to be a part of this community, an extension of this community, as we all together impact the nations for Christ. So it's really great to be back here in Grand Rapids. We just got back, 2 days ago? We've been all over the United States visiting family and supporters and the churches that love us and support us. So it's really good to be back here. So I'll give you just a little tidbit about what our ministry is, and then I'll get into a little more detail of what we do. So we serve at an international school called Black Forest Academy, or BFA, and it's located in Southwest Germany, and it primarily serves missionary families. And it takes a little explaining to explain why we're missionaries, but we work at a school. And the reason is because BFA doesn't pay any of their staff. Everybody who serves at BFA raises their own support to be there. That way they don't have to pay payroll. That keeps their costs very low for missionary families to be able to send their children to this school. In a lot of areas of the world, seeking and finding education for your children as a missionary family is sometimes very difficult. And a lot of nations of the world don't allow homeschooling. They don't, or there's just not access to good education where these missionary families are serving. And so BFA is one of the solutions that missionary families choose. I actually went to BFA as a missionary kid, and it was an excellent, wonderful experience. I loved it. I didn't really have a community of peers where I was, where my family was serving. And so to go and live there at Black Forest Academy was great for my social skills, for just having friends. I actually had friends when I was in high school, and yeah, it's a boarding school. So 80% of the high school are missionary kids. 50% of those are in the boarding program. So it's not a huge school. It's about 250 students. And we love it. We love doing life with these students. And so here's a couple of stats, okay? There are 63 nations represented at Black Forest Academy. And when I say represented, that means either the location where their families are serving, the nation where they were born, or their passport nation, okay? So that makes up 63. There's actually 30 nationalities. But these kids speak multiple languages. They come from all reaches of the globe. And so it's a huge melting pot. Represented also in the high school, there are 60 mission agencies represented doing ministry, and their families do ministry in all areas, not just one thing like church planting. They're also doing Bible translation. They're doing refugee care. They're doing medical missions. They're all over the world, and we as BFA staff and you as people who support a BFA staff member, we have impact in those 63 nations because we're enabling these parents to be able to stay on the field and do what they do and have a good solution for their kids, for their upbringing, for their education. So we love this ministry, and we're thankful that you guys are a part of it. I have two stories, if I may. I won't take up much more of your time. So just to kind of illustrate why BFA is important and what impact it has. So we know of a student who graduated, I think, three or four years ago now. And she and her family grew up in a nomadic tribe in the mountains of Pakistan. And they assimilated, they dressed like them, and they spoke their language, and they were doing, her parents were doing Bible translation there. And I just remember talking to her, and we had this amazing conversation where she explained to me why it was so great to come to BFA. Because she actually had friends that spoke English, that was a thing. She could actually play sports. In that culture, girls did not play sports. She said it felt kind of freeing and kind of weird to wear shorts on the basketball team, because she'd never played basketball in shorts before. and so these students get to come and have this experience, because one day they'll go to university in the United States, and so we see it as a really good stepping stone point for them to come from the cultures that they're living in to kind of have a pseudo-American experience before they go to university in the United States. So she was very excited that she was getting that experience. I know of another student who just graduated this year who, she is Moroccan. And the last church I was in, I couldn't actually say all these things because it was being televised. And she told us that it was amazing to stand in a room and hear 100 or so, actually there's 250 voices singing to God. She'd never experienced that before because she's had to worship in the confines of her own home and not be able to express that she is a follower of Jesus outside her home. So she was able to come and have a community and have a small group and go to church and praise the Lord together with a community of believers, which was an amazing story to hear. So, yeah, and we hear these stories like this all the time. And it's so humbling to realize, like, yeah, that we all serve the same God, we all worship the same God, and all these kids are coming from the far reaches of the planet, from all these different cultural backgrounds, and it's such an amazing place to be. And so we're very, very grateful to be able to serve there. One more thing. I keep looking at you. I'm sorry. I could go on. Just to give you a couple sentences about what we do specifically. So I am the communications lead. So what that means is I handle anything that has to do with like digital communication. So me and my colleague, we run the website. We update the school's website. We run our social media. And social media for our school is actually really important because the parents are watching and seeing what's going on at school on a daily, weekly basis. I produce the promotional videos. I do some recruiting things. And since all of our staff raise our own support, a lot of my work actually is to produce digital pieces, whether it's like digital print or video or photography or anything like that, that our staff can use to communicate to their churches, to their supporters. So I'm doing a lot of that work as well. My wife is training to be a life coach, and she's found that she's already been, she loves doing mentorships, and she loves pacing with the students. And she's expanding her vision to also empowering missionary, adult missionaries in their areas of service. So she's training to be a life coach and helping them follow the calling that God has placed on their life in the best way possible. And so that's her passion and her vision. So she's training to do that. She's almost done with her training. She's already started to have regular meetings with missionaries from all over the world on Zoom. Zoom is a great thing. You can do a lot of ministry on Zoom. So that's us. A couple of prayer requests we would have. One is our school is getting a new head of school. So you'd call it a director or the principal. The former principal has now taken a position with ACSI. I don't know if you know that organization. It's a Christian Science Association. Christian education organization. So we have a new head of school now, and we're just asking everybody that we see this summer to pray for him as he transitions in. He's coming from doing the same job in a school in Africa, Roslyn Academy. So I think the biggest challenge for him will be to assimilate to the German culture from an African culture. I think that might be a jump, but he has a huge heart for missionary kids. He is a missionary kid, and so we're very excited for him to come. So yeah, just keep him in your prayers. His name is Phil Dow, and yeah, we're very excited for this new chapter with Phil. The other prayer request I would have is just for us as we navigate the influx of refugees from Ukraine. There's a small refugee camp on the outside of our town, and we're just asking the Lord for ways that we can get involved with their lives. There's already some connections being made with the families that are settling in the area. What I would love is for students to be involved with the other high school students that are coming in. I think that would be a really cool opportunity. So, yeah, just pray for our community as we love our neighbors as they come in. And I think those are the two main prayer requests I have. So, yeah, thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Josh, and great to see the Crooks in full here this morning. When do you guys head back over, and what's the plan? Okay. And support is going okay?
Yeah.
Good. All right. Well, Josh, you can have a seat. We're going to pray. We'll pray for our missionaries as we do pretty routinely. We have a lot more flexibility right now in the summer months. We can go on for hours, Josh. If you want to come back up here and give us five more stories, that would be great. But we'll give Dan some time here, too, this morning. We don't want to cut him out completely. But I want to just take a moment and pray for you all. We'd love to pray. How can we pray for you this morning? If you have a request, we can take some time to do that right now. Yes, Jeremy, you can take some kids down, too, if you'd like to. bring us our last message in the series, the Into the Gray Zone series we've been doing for the last 3 weeks. We talked about what it means to eat well, listen well, drink well. That was last week. That got some good discussion after church, I was told. And this week, we're going to hear what it means to watch well. So Dan, when he heard what we were doing, he said, I want to teach on that topic. Will you let me teach? And I'm like, okay. And as always, when it comes to Dan, he's always got props. He's got the popcorn machine with him that he just brought, you know, just brought it in this morning. Like, hey, we're going to pop some popcorn. He's probably got a banjo and some magic tricks as well up his sleeves. So looking forward to hearing Dan. So Dan, if you want to come on up here, I want to just thank him for his willingness to do this. I also want to thank Ben in the back who is filling in for Adam today. It's great to have some folks that can step in for those of us who are taking a break on vacation, that sort of thing. So thank you, Ben, for that. Last week, Ben led worship, and yes, he can do sound, too, in the back. So it's great to have such a diverse group of gifted people here in our midst. Dan, you've got a message. Thanks for the book.
Yep,
God bless you. We're going to pray. Let's pray for just a minute.
Go ahead first.
Father God, I just want to thank you for my brother in Christ, Dan. Thank you for his willingness to teach this morning. God, with your spirit upon him, may he speak your words to us this morning, words of wisdom, words of blessing, words that we need to hear. Teach us this morning through Dan, I pray.
If you remember that growing up as a kid, absolutely. So, well, before I get started here, I got to take a little bit of a side note here before I get started, and it's more of a personal side note. Jeff took a lot of my talk away when he got up here, so I got to talk to him about that. But it was really neat to set over, and I was sitting over there, and I was sort of, my mind goes back because I'm old, and I started thinking of stuff and our families and stuff. And it's sort of a proud moment of me to be able to sit back and go, I remember when Alyssa was in youth group. And I remember Ivers and I and my family, my son Jake and them, were all sort of in the same group. And I think about that, and I think about Adam, who was in that group, and the people that have passed through my life that you go back and go, wow, where they're at today just makes you so proud to see that they, from that point, were listening to what the Lord had to say to them and where they were going. So, to Alyssa, proud of you. So, that's great. All right, so, Jeff stole my story here, but we have been going over for the last month in a book called Gray Matters. And, like Jeff said, when he was going down, talking about it, I don't know, 5 or 6 weeks ago, when he's going through the whole thing, I said, I like to teach on the one for watching because of my past and my past addiction to pornography, how that led me into some stuff. And I'm going, I'd like to teach about that because that's just something that's right down my line. Little did I know that as I got into it, that, boy, there's a lot more to this than just what you think it is. You know, we started out with eating and talked about, you know, when you eat, eating is good, but there is a part of going overboard, and there's a part of being too little. You can go to two extremes. You can watch so much what you eat that it's not healthy for you because you're so concerned, and that becomes an addiction. I mean, it really becomes an addiction that you're so worried on what you're eating all the time, or you're eating so much it becomes an addiction, and you have to watch that. Listening. I love to listen to music. Those of you who've ridden with me, I'm a 60s, 70s fan, and I'd join all the time. I always tell the joke about listening too much is that Ivers and I have been going on vacation now for 3 years, and there's horror things in my life, but one of the worst horror things I ever went through was Ivers down I-90 singing Petra as loud as he can in my car. I mean, that was just, I don't want to go through that again. Drinking was last week, and that drinking one, it was interesting. I think what I like about this series so far is that I did a message maybe a year or so ago, and it talked about the signs of a healthy church. and different signs of a healthy church. And one sign of a healthy church was, is the messages that are presented give you something to talk about and think about. You know, you come into church, you need to be challenged. You need to be challenged and stuff, because that is so important in our Christian life, to be challenged. This last week, Roy and I have had some great discussions on drinking. And Roy, bless his heart, Mr. Shingles, is that he comes from a camp that drinking is just not there. I mean, it's just not there, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. There's nothing wrong with that at all. To me, who goes, I like to have a beer every so often. I enjoy that. But the discussion Roy and I've had over it was just really good, because it really takes and says, okay, let's dig into God's Word. Let's see what God's Word says about it. And even if we don't agree on it, we still dig into it and talk about it. And we've had, you know, Roy sits in his chair and says, where in the Bible does it say beer? Where in the Bible? And so, you know, we go through that type of stuff, but it's a great conversation to have. So this book has turned out to be a lot bigger. It turned out to be, what is the difference between legalism and liberty? And where does that lie in our lives? And where do we as individuals have to decide where that line lies? And that's been really good. So here's the question. Who remembers the first movie they've ever saw? First movie you ever saw. Ivers, what's the first movie you ever saw? Star Wars? What is it? Okay. Anybody else? Come on. Who? Jerry? Bambi. Okay. Who else? Sound of Music. Okay. Anybody else? Yep. I can still remember the first movie I ever saw, and my grandmother took us grandkids to the theater to see this movie.
The only mother I've ever known. But my feet are set upon a road that I must follow.
From director Cecil B. DeMille.
I will teach thee.
Man shall be ruled by law, not by the will of other men.
Slaves are mine.
The Academy Award-winning film.
Let my people go.
Of the unforgettable definitive Bible story.
I know not his God, neither will I let his people go.
You have not obeyed the Lord.
This night, the Lord our God will deliver us from the bondage of Egypt.
They shall die under my chariot wheels.
So let it be written, so let it be done.
Starring some of film's greatest legends. The greatest epic of all time.
Behold his mighty hand. Those who will not live by the law shall die by the law.
The Ten.
Remember that movie? Yeah, I still, like twice a year, it's like one of those things I sit down and I love watching. It gives me a warm feeling. I just remember as my cousin, I can't tell you which cousins went with me, but I remember watching the movie at a Coronado Theater in Rockford, Illinois. And I remember that movie. And what I remember about it is that it was just a good movie. And as I got older, I looked at it and realized all of those characters are real. It's not computer generated. So all those people you see out in the field and all that stuff you see, that's real people. That's not a computer doing that. And I think about it, I said, holy cow, that's quite a feat to put all those camels in a row and who fed the camels and all that type of stuff. So, and doing that. There's a slide there next, Ben. This is from Brett. And Brett talks about, he's the author. He says, of all the areas of culture that was elicited passionate and wide-ranging responses from Christians, cinema is perhaps the most contentious. After I read that, I realized why Jeff kept pushing me to do this one and not the other ones, because this is the one that's most contentious. So why is this? I think it is because all of us look at what we watch differently. When he wrote this book, I think if you could go back and rewrite it, it would say cinema and social media is perhaps the most contentious thing that Christians have to decide. When growing up, I grew up in a church called Temple Baptist Church in Rockford, Illinois. And I can still remember some of the old people, which would be me now, that I thought were crazy as bedbugs, because they come out and said, going to a movie is the devil's work. And I went, wait a minute, then the Ten Commandments, and I really didn't think that that was the devil's work. How was the Ten Commandments the devil's work? But they were so intense that going to a movie was the devil's work. So my question is, were they right? Could be. That's part of this whole thing. Were they right? You know, God's word does not address going to movies directly. It doesn't say commandment number 11, thou shalt not go to a movie. It doesn't say that in there. But I think there is some verses here. I'm going to put this up to go through it. That go one more there, and I'm going to put some Bible. There you go. Matthew 26:41. Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Matthew 6:22. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Then 1 Corinthians 6:12, you say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. And even though I'm allowed to do anything, I must not become a slave to anything. And you think about that, and that verse there sort of goes back through this whole series. Is I'm allowed to do anything, but is everything good for me to do? The first movie ever made, and I somehow missed the clip, was called The Round Hay Garden Scene. And this is a three-second movie back in 1888 is when it was first done. Think about that, 1888. If Roy was here, I'd say a joke like that was when Roy was born. But 1888 is when the movie is done. And it's a video clip, and it shows three ladies in a garden, the sky walking around in circles. And I thought to myself, seemed to be nothing here in this movie that would be the devil's hand, other than I wonder who the director was that told that guy, just walk around in circles. Just walk around in circles. I don't know, for 3 seconds. So let's go back into, as we get into this, a little bit of history in the Christian movies and stuff. And this is where I found this book to be really interesting. In 1933, and I think that's that slide that maybe you passed up. In 1933, Henry James Forman wrote a summary that movies encourage young men and women into the life of delinquency and crime by stimulating desires of luxury and leisure. So he came back and said, hey, your kids go to movies, they're going to want luxury and leisure. And I thought to myself, well, okay, I like luxury and leisure. You know, that's pretty good. I enjoy that. But was he wrong again in his thoughts? Yes or no? That's part of that stuff we go through as we're talking about this. In a book by K.L. Bingsley, I'm reading this because I can't memorize all these quotes, he states that myriads of people, young and old, who regularly attend movies are relatively unaffected by them. He goes on to say, it's all about how we go about watching the film. The burden is on us. There is no religious case against the movies themselves, noted Billingsley, only the abuse and misuse of them. So think about that for a second. The movie itself, the thing for the movie, he said there is no saying on that. But it's what happens when we use the movies, or who directs the movies, or the content that's put in the movies, or where it's at. That's where the misuse comes from. But actually the movie itself, the Bible doesn't say don't go to movies. 1948, a movie from Europe, The Miracle, the Legion of Decency condemned this movie as sacrilegious, blaspheming, mockery of Christian and religious truth. The Legion of Decency was the Catholic Church. And the Catholic Church, when movies first came out, or when they were going in the 50s and stuff, they were very much hard against movies. No, 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 you don't go to movies. The Baptist religion, the Nazarene, back then, movies, no, you don't go to them. And they fought, and they fought, and they fought. but it still made it, this movie still made it to many movie screens that caused protest and eventually made it to the Supreme Court and was determined to be worthy of First Amendment protection. With this defeat, the censorship of movies from groups like the Legion of Decency came to a fast stop. This is where Satan and that part started to step in more, because now there was nobody out there watching or going to producers or doing stuff and saying, no, you can't do this, no, you shouldn't do this, no, you shouldn't do that. And that's where it became harder and harder. It wasn't until 1968 that the film industry put a rating in. Everybody knows that now. PG, PG-13, and NC-17. This was put into place at that time in 1968 because the moral majority and the Christian people pushing Hollywood, focus on the family, had a big part of this, of getting that ratings put in place. Side note, if you're going to go to a movie, Focus on the Family has a website called Unplugged. And if you're not familiar with it, you go to it, Unplugged, and it will review every current movie that's out there, and it will tell you what's in the movie, what you need to watch for, where it's at, help you make a decision. So this gives you a background of really what I want to get into today, and that is that when it goes to movies, each of us are different on what we can view as a movie. Each of us can look at something differently in a movie and how it had effect to us. Each of us has to decide what is best for us when we choose the movie to watch. Some people like horror movies. I can't watch horror movies. I can't watch Chainsaw Massacre. I can't watch Friday the 13th. I can't watch even the commercials with the guy advertising, you know, and the kids are going, run to the garage, you know. So, but I was forced to watch a horror movie about 5 years ago, and I still cringe every time I see this come up on TV.
Fortified survival bunker? Because right outside my door lurks a nightmare. Named Poppy.
A 5, 6, 7, 8! Everybody!
Poppy is the leader of the trolls, and it's not her fault she's so insanely happy. She just never faced a real problem.
I was out visiting Stacia and the grandkids, and Stacia says, why don't you go to the movie? I said, okay. So I load up in the car, and where we go see Trolls. I sat through that movie, and and now it's the big joke. You want to go watch the movie, Trolls? I will not. It comes on TV. I don't like. So, yeah, I had to sit through that. But each of us, you know, can sit through a movie and do that. Here's another movie clip that I want you to watch. And this is a movie clip of a movie that I thought was one of the best movies I've ever seen. I thought it was a great movie. It's rated R. But I thought it was one of the best movies I've ever seen. And I still, if it comes on or if I'm going to watch it, I like this. See if you watch this, see how many of you recognize this movie.
Come here, girl.
Stop! Let go!
What you looking at, old man?
Ever notice how you come across somebody once in a while you shouldn't have messed with? That's me.
Are you crazy, man? Get out of here, man.
Dad, you worked hard your whole life.
Maybe it's time you started thinking about
taking it easier.
These places are nothing like what you'd think they'd be.
No,
they're great.
Beautiful.
Kicking us out on his birthday. I told you this was a bad idea.
What the hell these Chinese have to move in this neighborhood for?
Dorothy mentioned specifically that it was her desire for you to go to confession.
And I confess that I have no desire to confess to a boy that's just out of the seminary.
Neighborhood. Why didn't you call the police?
I prayed that they would show up, but nobody answered. Why are you bringing me all this garbage anyway?
Because you saved Tao.
I didn't save anybody.
You're a hero to the neighborhood.
I'm not a hero.
We're having barbecue. You want to come over? We've got beer, too.
I might as well drink with strangers. Those guys were here the other night. What about them?
Just a gang.
And here's the deal. You stay away, because if I have to come back here again, it's going to be ugly.
What was it like to kill a man?
You don't want to know. Tao and Sue are never going to find peace in this world, as long as that gang's around.
What are you going to do, Walt?
Whatever it is, they won't have a chance.
You know, here is a movie that hits the part that we talk about, that everybody has to decide what that thing is in a movie they can do. Some people can go to a movie and see front nudity, and it goes right over them. It doesn't hit. It doesn't affect them. It doesn't do that. This movie here, the F word is used 75 times throughout the movie. I watch the movie, and I don't even realize that is being said, and it doesn't cause me to go out and swear. I'm in the construction industry. Lee knows that. It's like some guy's conversation, that's every third word. And that's what it is. But in this movie itself, you had a movie here that took a guy, it talked about his belief in God, and it got down to the movie that. It talked about his being prejudiced against a certain people and how he worked through that. It talked about how he handled violence. It talked about how he handled his wife's death. It talked about how he handled his family and who they were. So on a movie with everything that's in there, that's a great, if you haven't seen it, I really recommend it. You see a lot of good things that are in a movie that if we went back to what I grew up with that says, that's the devil's work, don't go see it. Well, there's a movie here that has so many good things in it to make you think about it that there's this one part in here that doesn't affect me. Now, if you're a person who tends to swear and this would be something that would trip you off, then I'd go, no, you don't go, each of us. It's essential that Christians, we recognize that a line of too far does exist. So in anything we do, whether it's eating, listening, drinking, watching, there is a line too far that does exist. Like in music, the line too far is listening to Petra going down the highway. That's a line too far that has been crossed. You don't do that line ever again, and it will never happen again in my car. So there's a line too far that you go. But we have to realize, though, that line too far is different for everybody. It's a joke. I laugh about it. But for Ivers, that line's not too far. That's great for him. For me, the line's too far. But the side of that is, too, is as believers in Christ, and as we eat, as we listen, as we drink, as we go through stuff, we have to also be careful that line that is not too far for us can be too far for somebody else. I like to drink a beer. Ivers likes a beer, too. But out of respect for his wife, Ivers doesn't drink a beer. That's awesome. That's love. That's respect. He shows that. So when we go out and stuff, do I do it often? No, I don't, just out of respect for him, because I know it puts him in the position for doing that. So we as believers have to realize that there's a line too far that's for us, but there's a line too far for people that are around us, and we have to be careful that we don't cross that line. There are some things we should not be watching, but those pressure points are different for every one of us. With movies have become, in the media life and stuff that we watch, are not as much as what they used to be. People used to watch movies, they'd watch 20 movies a year in theaters. It was not unusual for people to go watch, because that's where it was at. Well, since social media has been out, the average person goes to see a movie 5 times a year now. Is what they say, goes to theater. Doesn't include Netflix and the stuff you watch from home. But going to theaters, they watch about 5 movies a year. Social media is different now. Anybody want to guess how many hours a day, or so minutes a day, the average person spends on social media outside of work? How many minutes? How much? Say about what? 360? Any other guesses? The average person spends 147 minutes on their phone, on their computer, on social media outside of work. Think about that. That's over 2 hours of doing that. That's a lot of time on it. How many minutes do people watch TV a day? Yes, 180 minutes. These are all 2021 statistics. So 180 minutes a day. So if a person watches 180 minutes of that and 147 minutes of this, I'm sure they cross over each other. But you're still pushing close to 200 minutes, 250 minutes a day, or basically 4 hours a day that we're on a social media type. So let's go back to that point of saying, okay, what is that line or what is that area that triggers us that we need to be careful as believers to do? One thing in counseling and stuff, addictions is one area that people come and talk about. And I think sometimes we can forget that addictions just aren't small things. Addictions are everything in our life can become addictive. How many of you wake up, you don't have to raise your hand, how many of you wake up and the first thing you do is you reach over and you grab your phone in the morning to see what's going on? How many of you, you know, got to have the phone by the bed and doing that, you know, so it's there instead of leaving it away? We have to be careful of what that line is we cross or how that is to us, because we look at movies and we're looking at nudity or language or stuff like that, but that line also crosses into how much time we watch stuff and where that's at. The top 10 social media sites. Now, I put this out here so you can go click in your mind as you hear them. TikTok. How many of you have ever watched TikTok? I will tell you, it can become very addicting. I caught myself maybe, I don't know, a while back. All of a sudden, like 30 minutes went away. And I'm laughing because they're funny. But here's the thing, too. They're funny, but every so often one flips in that's an area that I shouldn't be at. And sometimes I'll go up, go through. So you have to be careful of that. But there is that time. Facebook. How many are on Facebook every day? Don't raise your hand. But YouTube. There's another one. WhatsApp. I don't even know what WhatsApp is. But it's there. Instagram. That's another one. Pinterest. Reddit. LinkedIn. Now, all of these sometimes serve a good purpose. Facebook, I like Facebook because then I get to see what's going on with Stacia and Ian and Edda and Cannon because it shows up on Facebook and I'm able to go through it and see what's going on. It's a great way to do it. Even my kids local, you know, Melissa pastes pictures on Facebook and I can look at it. My son, Jake, is on LinkedIn and that's turned into be even more than his regular job. His LinkedIn, he's got... how many followers now, Ivers? Like 60,000 or 70,000? Yeah. So he's got people that follow him every day, and that's a business for him. He makes money off of that now. So it's all not bad. But the thing is that we have to be careful where we spend our time and what we spend our time on. So a little homework assignment here for you to do this week. And it's interesting because this goes back to the time that Ivers and I did this in our youth group. And we took the kids and we gave them a picture of a clock with 24 hours on it and said, okay, we want you to take 24 hours and write down what you do for those 24 hours. Take a day last week and say, I got up in the morning at, be honest with yourself, at 6 o'clock, and from 6 o'clock to 6:15, I looked on my phone. And then I got up, and then I had breakfast, and then I did this, and did this, and did this. Out of this, the purpose for this is that we have a line, as we as Christians need to watch, that there's a line too far. there's a line too far in what we eat again, a line too far in what we listen, a line too far in what we listen. But I think times have changed even since this book has been written, and that is that line too far of looking at what we do on social media and where that's at. Now, how's this homework going to work? Well, it's really easy for you because when you go out in the parking lot, you're going to find that the youth group put on your windshield wiper a picture of a clock and the notes on it. So you can grab this off your windshield wiper and you can sit down and pick a day last week by yourself and just look at what you did in that 24-hour period. I still do this to myself every so often, not as much as I should, but there's times that I'm sure there's times that I'm doing stuff that I've crossed the line as too far because I'm wasting time or whatever it would be. So I think as we review back at this book, and this has been a great book, and if you haven't read it yet, Jeff has a copy that's really demolished, but it's an in-depth book that will really get into you in each of the areas to look at it and decide, what is that line, and have I crossed that line, and do I need to back up again? Do I need to reevaluate what I'm watching and how that affects me? Have I become desensitized to stuff that I shouldn't have been desensitized to? Am I the frog in the boiling water that has just been little by little by little that now I've overstepped where I should be and I've crossed that line too far? So this has been a great series and just really a good series that says this is stuff that I need to be aware of. As Jeff and Jody and I sit down, we talk about series. The one thing I wanted to ask you guys to do, and my cousin John Ortberg does a daily thing, and he put a message out about a month ago, I think it was, what areas would you like to see talked about? And that's, I think that goes with us here too. If there's areas that you would like to see us dig into and present, we'd love to have you tell us what those are, so that's something that we can do. So I'll leave you with a little thing here as you go, a couple thoughts. One, each of us is different and has to decide what the gray area is for you in each of these things that we talked about. Not what your spouse thinks, not what your friend thinks, not what your mother thinks, not what your dad. What is that gray area for you? What is that area that you look at to go, ooh, maybe I'm crossing that line too often, or maybe I'm avoiding something that I don't need to avoid because if I go see that movie, it's not going to hurt me. It's not going to make me fall off the edge of the earth. It's not going to make me go out and do stuff. Like, who remembers the movie Matrix? Remember the movie Matrix? That was a movie that was really hit hard because shortly after Matrix was Columbine, and the kids in Columbine happened to wear long coats, so they took Matrix and tied it in. That's the reason the Columbine Massacre. Now, don't know. But I think the thing is that we have to be careful on what we watch, but we don't want to avoid stuff that Gran Torino, a great movie, because we're afraid that something's going to happen. Number two, do that homework. It sounds like it's not there, but it's fun. Take some time, fill it out, look at it, and then evaluate yourself. Was this a good thing for me this week? Am I spending too much time here? Am I spending too much time there? Am I on the phone too much? You might find out if you're on your phone like 3 or 4 hours a day, you might have an issue. So keep that in mind. Lord, thank you so much for this series. Thank you so much for Jeff and the time he put into it. It's just amazing the time he puts in. And just thank you so much. Thank you for Ben, him stepping in today. As always, for our music, it was so much appreciated. And for the Crooks, for the time they put in and the love they have for you and their family, just continue to watch over them. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Grab some popcorn on the way. Take it home and do that. Sit around and visit. If you haven't met the Crooks, please do so before you leave. So it's worth it. They're a great family. Thank you much. And what are we on next week for teaching? Yep. Perfect. Good. You're next.
Yeah, don't forget me. I'm standing right behind him. Yeah. Good challenges today. And some of those challenges have to do with things that feel almost impossible to change because they're our lifestyle, things we do all the time. And sometimes that does go over the line. So those are mountains. And God is greater than all of those things. So let's sing about that before we leave. Everybody stand, please.
Why should I worry when giants come calling my name? Oh, my God is so much bigger than the troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power or riches or fame? Shaken, I won't be moved.
his power and is intended for his glory. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen. Have a blessed week. We'll see you again next week.